simple man. Well, Jesus, you know, if you're looking below, it's worse now than then. Cheating and stealing, time after time. Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time.
Midnight at high noon, but you know, we live in the darkest time ever yet, but the light of the gospel is still the brightest light on earth. Amen? God's word will illuminate the darkness no matter what. So let's turn to Romans chapter 1, verse 18, and we'll be talking and reading some of this scripture in just a moment. But the book of Romans has been called the Constitution of Christianity. Today, starting in Romans 1:18, Paul begins to build his case with the gospel. It's really the only answer to humanity's problems. If you've got a problem in life, Jesus can fix it.
Amen.
But Jesus doesn't fix all our problems. Sometimes he allows us to go through them, and we just take one day at a time, or step by step, and walk with him. Here we're going to see that Paul is eager and driven to get the message of hope out to everyone. So here's the question Paul's going to answer. Why can only the gospel fix us? Why is it that we have issues in our life, we have things going on, but it's the gospel? We might try to get other fixes, but it's the gospel that can actually fix us. You say, well, I'm not broken. Yes, we are. We are a broken humanity. We have lots of issues all the time. You know, during the first 100 years of Harvard Law School, students analyzed the book of Romans, actually had it in their academia, and it was part of their curriculum because of the careful way that Paul presented his argument. One of the things I had the privilege of teaching on the college level was the writing, argument and persuasive writing, and I really like that because I like arguments. And Paul does a great job here presenting his argument. He starts with a common experience and he shows how the theory of the gospel, and he explains all the facts of it so that we get the message of Jesus Christ, the message of the gospel, presented in such a way that Paul answers, if you will, our objections as he goes. So along the way, he raises objections, not only answers them, but he also shows actually how it strengthens his case. So this chapter is like the entire world is in a courtroom here, and the Apostle Paul is the prosecuting attorney, and God himself sits on the throne as a judge. And Paul's going to prove to the unbeliever that he is totally without excuse. I want to restate that, that the unbeliever is totally without excuse. And Paul presents his argument to prove this. So the three major themes that we find here, and we're going to examine in these verses. So I want to begin in verse 18, if you kind of follow with me. It says, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness, since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. Only the gospel can fix us because of man's willful self-determination. We're always trying to do it ourselves. We think we can fix everything. A friend of mine in Mississippi, I saw last week, it says, and I can't remember the quote, but it says, "I fix things" on his t-shirt. I thought that was kind of funny because, you know, we really can't fix everything. We see in the revelation of God's truth in verse 18, it says, "The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven." A father taught his kids, all of them, there is no God. And after he went on for a while talking about this, the littlest one looked up and he said, "Dad, you think God knows that we don't believe in him?" There is in every man's mind, every child's heart, the consciousness of God. And God has expressed himself even throughout all of his creation. It's through his word that his wrath against ungodliness is clearly made known. You know, a lot of people say, "Well, I don't believe in God. I don't believe the Bible." I often sometimes wonder, have they read it? Have they really read it and seen what God has to say? But man has built-in consciousness and an awareness of God. And it's proclaimed in the heavens and all throughout creation. Sometimes people ask, "Well, what about the heathen in the foreign land in the back Amazon jungles that has never heard the gospel?" Well, God has revealed himself to them through creation. They might not know the name Jesus, but they know whether there is a God in heaven. And they will either acknowledge him or they will reject him, even through the evidence of creation. God has manifest himself to all of us, and it's the revelation of God's truth. You see, the Bible in Psalm 19, verses 1 through 4, it says that the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. And we can see the reach of God's truth in Psalm 19, because it says, "The heavens themselves declare the glory of God." I was always amazed about newspapers that whenever we used to, decades ago, get newspapers delivered to our house and all, and have a horoscope in there. And it would say, if you're this or if you're that, and they would look up the stars and they would predict things. And I thought, how silly is this? As a kid, I thought, this is crazy. When you look up at the stars and you think about those are suns, if you will, those stars giving off light, and all of them that are up there, and if you get away from the city at night and you lay on your back out in a field away from city lights, it's amazing how bright the stars really are. And that's the handiwork of God proclaiming, "I am God." There is a God in heaven who has hung those stars there, the Bible says. So in verse 1 of 19, Psalm 19, it says, "The skies," that is the heavens, "proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech, they use no words, no sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens God has pitched a tent for the sun." Isn't that beautiful? That God has hung all of these things up there for us. The revelation of God's presence is made known throughout the heavens, in fact, throughout all creation, because it's universal, it's inescapable, it's unavoidable, it's there for mankind to see, that acknowledges, that is the proof of, if you will, that there is a God. And God has manifested himself to mankind, and it's a revelation of God's truth to us, the men determined to reject. The psalmist writes that the heavens declare the glory of God and the firmament shows his handiwork, and therefore man is without excuse. And then we see the resistance of God's truth. Man resisted in spite of the revelation of God's truth through his handiwork and in spite of all the truth of God's Word that He's given us in print, there is resistance to that truth. I hate to think about how many people will not go to heaven. They're not going to heaven because they resist the truth of God. They say, I just don't need that. I don't believe in that. That's just religious stuff. I don't have any use for it. But one day they'll wake up as they stand before the great white throne judgment, the judgment of the wicked dead, those who have rejected God, and they will find out for sure that there really is a God who did love them, and they rejected Him. Here again in verse 18, it says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all godlessness and unrighteousness. Notice these two, unrighteousness and godlessness, they're inseparably linked together. They're always together. The word suppress or hold in the King James doesn't mean to hold on. It means to hold back. But people suppress the truth with their wickedness. And the problem is that the world is full of people who have resisted God's truth, the truth of His Word. It's not that they can't believe, it's that they choose not to believe. And so we find that the second theme in Paul's argument is that the only gospel that can fix us, it is only the gospel that can fix us, because man's wicked self-deception. We deceive ourselves and say there is no God. The Bible tells us that we are our own deceptors. Or in verse 21, for although they knew God, they knew about God, they neither glorified Him as God, nor gave thanks to Him, but their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Man deceives himself by selfish indifference. Though they knew God, they knew that there was a God in heaven. You cannot deny this. Well, you can verbally deny it, but in your heart you cannot. I love that the Bible tells us that every man, woman, boy, girl, has been dealt a measure of faith. God has given you the faith already built into every human being. God has given you the faith that if you will exercise that faith, if you will place that little bit of faith that God has already given you, and you'll place it in Jesus, then you will be saved. Amen? Amen. You say, saved from what? I'm not lost. I had God tell me that one time. I don't need to be saved. I'm not lost. You will be saved from the penalty of your sin, from the devil's hell, because there is a judgment day coming. Man's deception is from his own sophisticated ignorance. When Diane was an English faculty secretary, and I taught at TCC and FSU, and one of the things that amazed me is how such intelligent people can be so futile in their thinking. They get so educated, so narrow-minded, they think it's all science or it's all academia. They don't have any room for faith. They don't have any. And it would hurt us as we would strive to minister, to witness to people on campus. And their focus, and I'm talking about faculty, not students. It amazed me how open students are to the Word of God, given an opportunity to hear it. But faculty, because we're so educated, we're so brilliant, we're so self-sufficient, that we reject the very truth of God's Word. Verse 22 says, although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of immortal God for the images made to look like mortal human beings and birds and animals and reptiles. Rather than accept the evidence of God, they'd rather create their own gods in their likeness, something they can identify with. I think about a story in the Bible, and I can't get the reference right now, but it was where they kept setting up their false god in the temple, and they'd come back the next day, and that false god would be laying on his face, and they'd set him back up, and he'd be laying on his face, and that's because the one true God says, there is no false god going to stand on my turf, and he'd lay him down, he'd have him bow down to the original, the one and only true God in heaven. Amen. You may know that the word fool here is the word from which we derive our English word moron. It's a derivative of the word idiot and imbecile. Many educated people are literally fools and futile in their thinking because of their rejection of God in heaven. And then we see the shamelessness of idolatry. Verse 24 says, therefore God gave them over in their sinful desires of their hearts to sexual immorality for the degrading of their bodies with one another. Because of their deification of idols and their seriousness of such, Paul repeats, God gave them over, and he repeats this three times once in verse 24, then in 26, and later in 28. The third point of his argument is that only the gospel can fix us because of man's self-destruction. Verse 26 goes on to say, because of this, God gave them over to a shameful lust. Even their women exchanged natural sexual relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed shameful acts with one another and received in themselves a due penalty for their error. So we see that man becomes sexually perverted. The text here speaks of filthy sins of Sodom. You know about that. And the scripture says that sodomy is both vile and unnatural. If you want to know how God feels about homosexuality, just go back to the smoldering ruins of Sodom and Gomorrah and take a look. But man has also become not only sexually perverted, he has become socially perverted. People who treat sex lightly will treat human beings lightly. We see this in prostitution, sex trafficking, and other types of sexual perversions. And finally, man becomes spiritually perverted. Verse 32 says, although they knew God's righteous decrees that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but they also approve of those who practice them. Most entertainment today is applauding sin. It celebrates fornication, adultery, drunkenness, crime, vice, and selfishness. The devil knows that if he can put these things out in front of us and we learn to discount them and just take them with a grain of salt, we become comfortable with them. Sin, listen, will take you farther than you want to go. It will make you stay longer than you want to stay. And it will cost you more than you want to pay. Because of their perversion, Paul writes, God gave them over to shameful lusts. In verse 28, furthermore, it says, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a depraved mind. You see, when men and women choose to reject God, God will let them come to a point. Now, the Holy Spirit will keep prompting and prompting and prompting. Keep trying to draw you in. Keep trying to help you realize that there is a God and that He loves you and died for you. But as they reject this, He says, okay, enough is enough. Have it your way. Have it your way. And men go off the deep end and they do crazy stuff. And it's all about them and their world because there's no God to worship and to love and to know that God loves them. No wonder the Apostle Paul says in verse 16 of this chapter, I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to each of us. As a believer, you know that Jesus Christ took our sins. He took them away. He carried them away by going to the cross. And He suffered. He bled. And He died in agony for your sins. And Jesus, with His blood, atoned for our sins. He paid the price for all sins, all mankind's sins. And He says, all you have to do is accept the payment that I made for you. You know, if somebody wanted to give you a house, a big, fine, three-story house, 10,000 square feet, beautiful mansion, and they said, I want to give this to you, and you said, well, I don't know, I don't think I want it. I don't think I want that house. Then you've rejected it, and you will not have it. God's love has been offered. He made the sacrifice, and there is offering it to you. At Christmas, we exchange gifts. And if someone was to bring you a gift, it's yours for the taking. But if you refuse to take it, then you're without it. And that's exactly where mankind stands today, as they reject God's love and grace and forgiveness. But thank God you confessed your sin and you surrendered your life to God. He saved you. He forgave you. He cleansed you. And now He's given you joy and peace. He's given you a hope in living and a purpose in life. He's even given you hope in dying and a future that's steadfast and sure. That's what Jesus will do for anyone today when they surrender their lives to Him. All that we have to do is say, Jesus, I believe You are the Son of God. Died on that cross to pay for mankind's sin, including mine. And Father, I accept Your gift of eternal life because I put my faith and trust in who You are and what You have done for me. And mankind said, Amen. Thank You, Jesus, for all You've done. Would You stand with me?